Welcome to the Vintage Hollywood Archive Channel. Amiable, effervescent leading lady in Hollywood from 1929, but virtually unknown until she very touchingly played a waif opposite second husband Charles Chaplin in Modern Times. Paulette Goddard enjoyed a success beyond and independent of Chaplin. What made Paulette Goddard the most special woman in Charlie Chaplin's life? Make sure to watch the video until the end and leave your thoughts in the comments. If you're new here, join our wonderful community by subscribing to the Vintage Hollywood Archive channel. The Gamine, Paulette Goddard. An outstanding woman, independent, unconventional, and intelligent. Vivacious, gorgeous, intelligent, and bedecked with both jewels and men, one often contingent upon the other, Paulette Goddard led one of the most fascinating lives during Hollywood's golden age. Three of her four husbands were celebrities, that's fairly common knowledge, but her first marriage while still in her teens was to a lumber tycoon from North Carolina. Much out of character with the glamorous image of Paulette whining, dining, and being squired around Hollywood and New York. Paulette Goddard was smart, sexy, clever, crafty, and foxy. She was also a major contract star at Paramount for nearly all of the 1940s, although even at the height of her movie fame, Goddard was perhaps better known, as she is now, for her off-screen exploits, romances, and scandals. When more than 40 years after her greatest stardom, Paulette Goddard left a multi-million dollar estate, including priceless art, fabulous jewels, and magnificent properties. It was the culmination of years of not only hard work, but also canny opportunism and a healthy dose of feminine wiles. Despite leading a high life both in Hollywood and abroad, Goddard, according to the authors, was not a celluloid damsel typical of her era. She was independent, unconventional, and intelligent. A childhood that was impoverished educationally, emotionally, and financially toughened her. Forced to drop out of school at age 14 to support her mother and herself, she married a rich husband who provided her with the first of the many settlements she would receive throughout her life. She was thus enabled to be professionally and socially selective and to ignore the intrusive demands of press and public. Paulette Goddard was born Pauline Marion LeVay in Whitestone Landing, Long Island in 1905. She was the only child to Jewish cigar manufacturer Joseph Russell Levy and English Episcopalian Alta Mae Levy. Paulette's story is well known. She went to work at age 14, shortly after the breakup of her parents' marriage. She was brought up by her mother. They had to move from New York to Canada to Kansas to escape her father's custody. She later met her father in the 1930s when she had become famous. In a 1938 interview published at Collier's magazine, Goddard had claimed that Levy was not her father. Consequently, her father filed a suit against her, claiming that the interview had cost him his job and reputation. Goddard then lost the case and was forced to pay her father about $35 a week. She quit studies at an early age to support her mother, briefly attending Mount St. Dominic Academy at Caldwell, New Jersey, and Ursuline Academy at Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. She took up modeling at the age of 10 with Saks Fifth Avenue and moved to fashion designer Hattie Carnegie as a teenager. As a young woman who struggled financially, she helped support herself as a fetching member of a Ziegfeld show. Reportedly, an uncle used his influence to get her a job with producer Flo Ziegfeld, who billed her as Peaches Browning, Frances Heenan, in his 1926 hit No Fooling. She left the show after only 3 weeks to appear in the play The Unconquerable Male, produced by Archie Selwyn. It was, however, a flop, and closed after only 3 days following its premiere in Atlantic City. She hit the jackpot and married into wealth, but decided the life of a grand dame was not for her, ditched the husband, and headed for Hollywood. Her first husband was Edward James, president of the Southern States Lumber Company. Although she was only 16 at the time and considerably younger than James, they married in 1927. It was a short marriage, and Goddard was granted a divorce in Reno, Nevada in 1930, receiving a divorce settlement of $375,000. However, by 1931, she had obtained a Reno divorce and was headed for Hollywood to break into the movies. Taking her mother's maiden name, Goddard played a series of bit parts in films. Once in Hollywood, in her blonde cutie phase, she added decoration to such Goldwyn productions as Roman Scandals and Kid Millions. Goddard and Goldwyn did not get along, and she soon started working for Hal Roach Studios, appearing in a string of uncredited supporting roles for the next 4 years. Studio publicity portrait for Modern Times, in which Goddard had her first substantial film role. Her personality inspired the character of Gamine in Modern Times, a young girl whose father has been killed in a labor demonstration and who joins forces with Chaplin. "The couple are neither rebels nor victims, but," wrote Chaplin, "the only two live spirits in a world of automatons. We are children with no sense of responsibility, whereas the rest of humanity is weighed down with duty. We are spiritually free." In a sense, then, they are anarchists. Although still unknown as a performer, she attracted the attention of Charlie Chaplin. Chaplin was the most recognizable and beloved of all silent film stars, but he also had a troublesome predilection for very young women. However, the same year as she signed with Goldwyn, Goddard also began dating him, a relationship which received a substantial amount of attention from the press. Undeterred by his failed relationships, Chaplin continued working as the biggest film star of his generation. 9 years later, he married former child fashion model and Broadway star Paulette Goddard. Goddard, 22 when they first met, lied to Chaplin, claiming to be 17, which didn't stop Chaplin from moving her into his mansion shortly after. Chaplin had been invited for a weekend cruise aboard Joe Schenck's yacht. Schenck was the then president and chairman of United Artists, the company Chaplin had helped to found along with Doug Fairbanks, Mary Pickford, and D.W. Griffith. Paulette, another guest, was considering investing $50,000 of her alimony payment in a dubious movie company and asked Chaplin's advice. Not only did he persuade her to forget this dodgy deal, but also to revert her hair color to its natural brunette. Paulette had become a Hollywood platinum blonde, possibly in a bid to win her more parts from studios. Obviously, taking more than a shine to this pretty and charismatic actress, he bought out her Roach contract and signed her up for himself. The fruit of their professional relationship was the film Modern Times. It would take long pages to list all the women Charlie Chaplin was on intimate terms with, most of them being young, naive teenagers who were absolutely taken aback by the fact a movie star had fallen for them. Paulette Goddard started out that way, but in the end, after a relationship lasting for almost 10 years, it turned out she wasn't anything like it. What made Paulette stand out? Why was their marriage so different from all the others in Chaplin's life? For goodness sake, we don't even know if they were married or not. The two immediately fell in love and seemed to be inseparable during their first year together. The bond between us was loneliness. She made positive effect on Chaplin's sons, Charlie Jr. and Sidney, looked up to her as a big sister and loved to play with her and have her around. The flip side of the coin was that Chaplin's dedicated chauffeur and private secretary, Torichi Kono, felt usurped by Paulette's newfound place in the Chaplin home and resigned, though not before Chaplin gave him and his wife $1,000 each and secured a job for him at United Artists Japan. Paulette and Charlie went everywhere together, and Charlie even bought a yacht so they could spend Sundays cruising out. The purchase took place in secret, and made Paulette extremely happy. They had many joyful trips aboard the Panacea during the time they spent together. Their most frequent destination was Catalina Island, a little isle near the Californian peninsula, which Charlie has been fond of long before their first encounter. Modern times saw a brilliant team-up for Paulette and Charlie. He, as the tramp, and her as the gamine, surviving by her wit and courage on the waterfront, stealing bananas and handing them out to her fellow urchins. You can see Paulette as many things in this film, a female version of Charlie himself, a loner at odds with the world, making her own rules, dictated by circumstance or, on the same track, the kid grown up, a female version of course, though this leads again to the Charlie girl. Perhaps the main difference between them in the film is the way in which their characters defy authority. Charlie, with an air of innocence, whilst Paulette certainly does so with intent and purpose. Paulette was pretty much an equal in modern times, and the ending, the two outsiders against the world silhouetted as they walk off bravely into their future and a sunset, gave a new twist to the quintessential Chaplin ending. This time, for the last time, not alone. It also marked a turning point in Goddard's career when Chaplin cast her as his leading lady. Her role as the gamin, an orphan girl who runs away from the authorities and becomes the tramp's companion, was her first credited film appearance and garnered her mainly positive reviews. Frank S. Nugent of the New York Times described her as the fitting recipient of the great Charlotte's companionship. When the film had been completed and premiered at Grauman's Chinese Theater on February 12, 1936, Chaplin and Paulette went for a trip around the Pacific Rim, taking in Hawaii and Singapore along the way. The major event of this trip was that they were at last married, though neither of them would confirm this to reporters upon their return to California. But it was not all plain sailing. There is little doubt that Charlie and Paulette were very good for each other for a time, and that time was somewhat longer and happier than Charlie's involvement with either of his two previous wives. Following the success of Modern Times, although Chaplin worked slowly, he had planned other projects with Goddard. However, Goddard was worried that the public might forget her, so she signed a contract with David O. Selznick and appeared in the comedy film Young Hearts in 1938. Following that, Goddard also had films under MGM including Dramatic School and The Women. Before Vivian Leigh was signed, Paulette was the leading contender in the race to play Scarlett O'Hara in Gone with the Wind. Other top candidates who were considered were Joan Bennett and Jean Arthur, but Paulette was at the top of the heap. Her inability to produce a marriage certificate proving her domestic status with her husband Charlie Chaplin, along with the entrance of Miss Leigh into the Scarlet Pool, was enough to dismiss any hopes of securing the role. The strength of her screen test, along with all the publicity the part generated for her, did however help her snag a long-term contract with Paramount Pictures. While Paulette was said to have had a brief fling with George Gershwin during her time with Chaplin, in the end, she may have been just too ambitious and independent to stay at Charlie's careful, creative pace, and they eventually began to drift apart. Chaplin's bullish ways resurfaced as his attempts to control Goddard's career pushed her to her limits. The couple split shortly after the 1940 premiere of their film, The Great Dictator. Unlike his former wives, though, Goddard was an independent 20-something starlet who found success before and after their relationship. Preferring comedies and adventure films, she then became one of the most important stars of Paramount for over 10 years. Soon she made a hit thanks to the comical couple she formed with Bob Hope in three comedies including The Ghostbreakers. Realizing the immense impact of their new star with the public, Paramount gave her a series of successful roles. Entertaining, strong and dynamic women with prestigious partners such as Fred Astaire, Charles Boyer, Fred MacMurray, or Ray Milland. In this same period, she became the favorite actress of the most powerful producer of Hollywood, Cecil B. DeMille, with whom she had a tumultuous relationship but who offered her three epic roles with John Wayne and Gary Cooper, which was the major success of that year for the Paramount Studios, and Unconquered in 1947. She was at the top of her career when her talent was finally acknowledged with an Oscar nomination for Best Supporting Actress for her contribution in So Proudly We Hail, a film about nurses during World War II. Paulette received alimony payment and the yacht Chaplin had bought during their courtship. Part of the settlement was also to include one more film directed by Chaplin for Paulette. This never happened. But the 1940s saw her career just get better and better as she appeared in a huge number of films. In 1944, she married actor Burgess Meredith. They divorced in 1950, and 8 years later, she married the German novelist Erich Maria Remarque, author of the classic All Quiet on the Western Front. Another novelist and a close friend of Paulette's, Anita Loose, claimed that Paulette was the inspiration for her heroine in Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. Luce would later say, "Gentlemen prefer blondes until they get a load of Paulette." Her personal life was no less lively than her screen career. Paulette Goddard also found herself being stalked by the US government. An outspoken liberal in her own right and the ex-wife of several well-known lefties, the FBI and the HUAC came after her for her political views, along with Chaplin. Like Chaplin, Paulette's life ended in Switzerland. She and Remarque had moved there, and on one occasion they even chanced upon the Chaplins, Charlie and Una, in a restaurant and joined each other for dinner. Remarque died in 1970, but Paulette survived him by 20 years, dying on the 23rd of April, 1990, from heart failure. You may think Paulette Goddard had this whole dame thing down pat, wrapping a genius around her little finger, becoming a major movie star, marrying a millionaire. It all came as easily to her as breathing. Paulette Goddard's example as a smart, sassy, foxy dame who knew how to get what she wanted, even when she didn't know what it was. If you liked this video, don't forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe if you're new here.